What, the 15th of July? Boy, time continues to march on. You know, we had quite a weekend with the attempted presidential shooting that happened on Saturday. There's a bunch of other stuff that Tony's come across and said we need to have a conversation with everybody. So that's what we're doing. So I'm going to step out of the way. I know that Tony's got some really cool stuff to talk to you about. Tony, my friend, it's all yours.
Hey, thank you, Bob. Just so you guys know, this is going to be a little bit scattered because on the road, I have a laptop, a big screen TV, and my notepad here. So I'm going to try to go back and forth. And the reason I have all this stuff open is because that I'm going to respond to your guys' emails. And I appreciate you guys sending me emails, all that stuff. I know from what happened the last couple of days that people are concerned. What are you thinking? And all that stuff politically. And, you know, would this have any effect on the dinar on one way or the other? If Trump wins, if Biden wins, if there's an assassination on either side, what if Biden, you know, the guy's old. He's, you know, he could kick the bucket any time. So we'll talk. We'll delve into a little bit about that. But here's the thing. All right. So there, I'm still concerned. The last audio I did with you guys, I talked about Hamas moving into Iraq. All right, you guys, that's still in play. That is a big issue. All right, we're not going to support Iraq in any way, shape, or form if Hamas shows up. That's a game changer. So I got an email from a gentleman. I won't use his last name. His first name's Todd. Sent me a couple great emails. So I put in the link to the article that he sent me, and you guys can see it below. And talking about how the United States is, you know, warns against Hamas move from Qatar to Iraq. All right, and then he asked me, you know, what, you know, the moral perspective, because, you know, they're completely anti-West. They just slaughtered 1,200 Israelis last October. And it's obviously a proxy movement for Iran. There's going to be, you know, they're there. It's a suicide mission to the very end. There's no compromise. There's nothing. And so what is the moral, you know, is there a moral dilemma in having Iraqi dinar because of that? Well, you know, I'd say no, because and here's the main reason, you guys, and we'll get into some more stuff also. You know, you can't, the Iraqi people, obviously there's a lot of religious attachment to it, but they have nothing to do with Hamas at all. All right, that's number one. Number two, if Iraq does start, you know, where it's a hub for terrorism, not the civil war that they're in against the Sunni and the Shia, but it starts going outside of that, then yeah, it'd probably be, you know, let's say if we knew that the Iraqi dinar was going to revalue within a certain time and we knew the exact answer, would there be a moral issue? With me, there would. It just simply would. I wouldn't know what to do. I really wouldn't. So, you know, going back to when I first started this, all right, so someone sent me an article that came out like in 2011 against me and was attacking me personally. And I'm ad-libbing a little bit, but it talked a little bit. It's like, well, you know, Breitling's one of these guys that, you know, he knew some senators and, you know, he knew somebody at the UN. And no, you guys, I knew a lady. So I give talks about geopolitics, and I met a lady in San Diego. She worked for the IMF. She didn't have any decision-making authority or anything like that. And we exchanged emails, and I would ask her about, you know, the policy on the IMF. Like, what do they do? How does this work? Can they help a country add value to the current? All that stuff. That's where I got that from. Wasn't because I was best friends with anybody or anything like that, you know. So what it is someone twisting a relationship that I developed with somebody, and you know, it's like, oh, this guy, he says he knows everything. No bullshit. All right. I did work with the Republicans. I worked with several senators on the group that I was with. It wasn't a personal relationship or anything like that. The group that I was with did research for the Republicans. That's where I cut my teeth on all this stuff. It was just simple research. We never told anybody about our opinions. Nobody gave a shit about our opinions. That's not what we were there for. We were there to go out and find information so people can make policy decisions. And it was a huge opportunity for me. All right. So that's where those relationships came from. Later on down, it developed into me privately teaching geopolitics, the introduction to geopolitics. And then later on down the road from that, comparative geopolitics. So it's been a great run, a huge opportunity. But no, I don't, you know, I don't have the type of relationships out there where, you know, I know everybody in every agency or anything like that, never claimed to. It's all bullshit. All right. There's another issue here. Now, you guys don't know about this, but I actually went after a site, legal for legal problems. And what they were doing is I quit. I stopped posting on these certain, some of them were membership sites. I had nothing to do with the memberships or anything like that. I was just part of that group. And then it turned out to be a member. I'm not going to throw any names or anything like that, but they were hosted on servers. All right. Well, I'm sitting there one day, next thing you know, it's popping up on my email. It's like, hey, you know, when did you say this? You didn't tell me this. And somebody was using my name, even though it was a, you know, Breitling's not a real name, but somebody was pretending to be me. Yeah, it's going to revalue $3.23. So, you know, that's the fiasco that this whole dinar thing that I completely, I don't regret meeting you people at the meetings. I don't regret teaching geopolitics. I don't regret saying that I believe the Iraqi dinar is going to add value. But it's you know, it's been a disaster for the dishonest. I can't believe the bullshit crowd that is out there and the stuff that they try to do. Try to use your name or twist things or even attack you. But anyways, no big deal. This, you know, never hurt me or anything like that. Time will always tell, you know, like I said, if people could throw all the stuff out there, but I'm the guy out there that was meeting people directly, shaking your hand, even if you disagree with me on politics or whatever like that. My objective was to make sure that people knew that, you know, this was an opportunity up. And I always told you guys until the day that it's not. And with the Hamas thing right now, you guys, it's not off the table. It's, you know, I don't see a threat yet, but I'm telling you that could be a big deal. All right. That could be a big deal. So the person who sent me the email is asking me about all the stuff that said, you know, it's all, somebody tried to damage me as much as possible and they lost. Still here. All right. In fact, since then, I started talking a little bit more about geopolitics and how stuff works. And, you know, that's when people, you couldn't get a seat in some of the events that we put together. It's incredible. It's one of the best opportunities, one of the best times I've ever had in my life, thanks to you guys. God bless you. So there's another issue, and we'll get into some more stuff here. All right. So it's kind of funny. The people that are against me and my politics, and you know, you guys know I've always been, even before I was into all this stuff, I was always an anti-conspiracy guy. Like the day I got out of high school, you know, back in the day when the internet first came out, GeoCities, I had a site. I had an anti-conspiracy site. I'd been working on that stuff for years. And it was just a way for me to personally sift through all the information that was coming out back in those days. Remember, this is before the internet, when I actually started researching this stuff. You know, how do I know this is true? How did this, you know, and it just built up into a hobby, actually. But I found that most of this stuff, almost none of it can be proven in a court of law. And there's some serious psychological issues and strategies that these people who throw this stuff out there on the type of person they're aiming this at, the type of people they aim this at, these people don't need facts. The way their brains work, they can't help it. It's not, some of them are smart, some of them are stupid, some of them are right in the middle. But the way their brains connect things, and so these guys throw this out there, it's like casting a net. They find those people that think like that. And when I mean think like that, I don't mean about what it is that they're saying. On what I mean is how they go from one aspect of the conspiracy to the next. The link. All these weird links that don't exist. So there's books written about this on at length, talking about how, you know, between 1-5 to 10% even of every population of every country, where people, the way that their minds work, you know. So the reason I'm saying that is because I'm not interested in arguing with people. That's why. Because you're most of the time you're dealing with those type of people. It doesn't matter. So you guys probably remember, I put out an audio a couple months ago, and you know, this guy was all these accusations. So what I did is I set him up. I read every flipping word of his email and answered every question, every single question. And so I get another email from the guy. All right. And so what does he do? He doesn't respond to anything that I said. He just goes into a completely different dialogue. And then at the end of his second dialogue, he says, "You never answer any of my questions." That's a number one tell. The guy, so just so you guys know, he's not being creative. He's not sneaky. He's not dishonest. That's the way his mind works. He completely, you know, it's, that's why I said there's no reason at all. He's not doing it on purpose. I've been dealing with that for 20 years. They will not talk about what it is. So if you answer the question, they just skip right on down the road. They won't even acknowledge that what you just said. So that's why I don't get into it, because most of the people who believe in that harebrained cat, you know, the bullshit, batshit crazy garbage, you know, that's where they're at in life. And there's no way, there's no way. So, you know, what you do is you just talk to people that have good reasoning skills, and they can look at things and figure it out. So when I would do geopolitics, talking to certain crowds, those people were already filtered out. They were filtered out by the companies and stuff that we work with. And so they were all top notch. You know what I mean? The dinar crowd, you know, it's not filtered out. God bless all of you, but it's, you know, it's a wild bunch. But I'll give you guys this though. Most of the people, probably, and Bob can attest to this, probably 90%, 95% of the people are just absolutely spot on, good, honest people. You know, no ill intent, nothing bad, nothing. They just, they're in this because there might be something here financially that can better their life and better their families. No agendas or anything like that. But there's 5% of you in there that, you know, sending me hate mail for years. So I'm bringing this up. I'm bringing this up because I've gotten a lot of emails about this stuff lately, and why, you know, some of you don't like me talking about that stuff. Well, there's most people do, believe it or not. You know, they want to know the answers, and I always attach it with Iraq because that's what we're talking about. So let me delve into this. All right. First of all, let's talk about the numbers of Trump and Biden, that and what type of effect it would have on Iraq. All right, so we all seen what happened the last couple days. Some punk kid tried to take out Donald Trump, and for all the for all the mega conspiracy theorists out there, all right, Bob and I were just having a, so I have one of my buddies, ex-CIA, and he was only in the CIA for a couple of years. And so we were exchanging text about what was going on, and I took a picture of a report from NBC or something like that, talking about how one of his classmates in high school said that, yeah, no, this guy tried to sign up for the high school rifle team when he was a freshman. And it was such a lousy shot. You know, A, he didn't make it, and he never even tried to join for the next 3 years of high school. So, you know, basically, you know, we were laughing because it's like, you know, here's this kid, little goofy. You could tell there's something off with him. He steals his dad's gun. The gun doesn't have a scope, so he's using irons. And he's a lousy shot to boot. And, you know, he took a piece of Trump's ear off. Trump's the luckiest guy on the planet. But anybody who thinks that the deep state or that Trump's camp was trying to, you know, there's people on the far left going, well, Trump did this on purpose and he's just trying to create a sympathy vote. They picked the wrong guy to do that. I mean, you couldn't pick a worse person. So that's the end of that conspiracy. But I'm going to be honest with you. I tell you what does scare me, though. It does scare me that there was an open roof and they designated as a dangerous spot or a flagged spot for a potential, you know, and nobody was there. It doesn't matter if the local police or the Secret Service, nobody was there. It does disturb me. I watched the video, and you guys can all watch the video too, that people are pointing out that there's a gunman that scaled the wall and got on the roof, and the police were just kind of like, huh, I wonder what's going on over there. Why they're yelling, hey, there's a guy with a gun on the goddamn roof over here. 130 yards, supposedly, between 3 to 130 yards away from where the speech was given. It does disturb me that a police officer climbed up, scaled the same wall, and confronted the guy. The guy pointed his gun at the police officer, and he split. Now, we don't know. There's no more information. We, you know, to say that he just took off and didn't report or anything like that, you know, don't be an idiot. Don't be an ass. But somebody confronted the guy, and it didn't stop him. So I don't know if the police officer was caught flat-footed. And, you know, guys, you know, how do you know how you're going to react when someone points a rifle at your head? You know what I mean? You know? So, but it does disturb me that everybody, now that people know that there's a guy on the roof with a gun, still nothing done, and the guy gets a couple shots fired off, one, you know, grazing Trump's head before the Secret Service take the guy out with a headshot. It's like, what, you know, how can that happen? That's disappointing. You know what I mean? It's like, how could something like that happen? The Secret Service are the elite of the elite. At least that's what we thought. And the conversation that I had with Bob on here is like, you know, maybe these people aren't as elite as they portray themselves on these movies and these stories and all that stuff. Because it seems like there's a lot of people that get shot all the time. You know, I think what we need to do is step back, and humans are humans, you guys. There's not going to be an elite group out there that can do everything. And they're just perfect. And they're just, you know, obviously. That's obvious from what we just saw. So here's what people don't realize, that because of that event, that dipshit, if he hated Trump so bad, that guy just guaranteed Trump's win. That's my opinion. I don't think Trump can lose right now. I think it's impossible. Absolutely 100% impossible for Trump to lose. So, you know, going back on my other conversations where I talked about where, you know, I have a problem with Trump. Remember, I voted for Trump twice. Let's go through my record. I voted for Trump twice. Bob and I had a radio show called Patriot Radio America that was built just to support Trump. All right. So I'm not an anti-Trump guy or anything like that. I have one issue with the guy. One issue. Don't pull us out of NATO. You know, that is there to protect us from Russia. And so, and it still stands today. You know, I'm not going to do a sympathy vote or an empathy vote. If Trump got shot or if his kid got shot, I'm going to vote for Trump. Bullshit. That guy wants to pull us out of NATO. You're not getting my vote. You're not getting this white boy's vote. I can tell you that right now. So that's the thing, you guys. So let's go over a couple timelines. All right. I want to talk about Taiwan and I want to talk about Ukraine. And we're just talking, you know, authority. Where, you know, who has the best information and what could happen? Because the reality is, you know, Biden's a disaster. There's some stuff that he's doing that I like, but it's Republican policy. And I still don't know how the hell he's was there a deal being done? You know, the CHIP Act, that's a Republican strategy. The PG2, the bringing back our factories from China, that's a Republican strategy. That's all Republican strategy. So how Biden's doing this or what happened, or I still don't know. But those things are good, all right? But it doesn't do any good when you build an economy and do all that, and then you go after the energy, which props the economy up. It none of that makes any sense. So, you know, no matter what, they're stuck in retard mode. So real quick before I get into these quotes, all right? Remember that I was upset because Trump got us out of Afghanistan. So you people who don't understand that, you need to go do the audio that Bob and I put together. And I'll find the link for it. I'll find it and put the link so you guys can see it. You don't have to search for it. All right. But it goes through Chris Miller, the Secretary of Defense. And now he's given a talk on how Trump told him you need to pull us out of Afghanistan and out of Iraq. He was able to pull us out of Afghanistan. The reason I'm saying that is because people don't know Biden pulls out of Afghanistan. No, it was Trump. And he made it legal. And he had to do it. Biden had to pull it out, pull the troops out under his watch. So no matter what, doesn't matter how it turned out. You know, Trump can say all he wants. Well, I wouldn't have done that. Well, that's, you know, bullshit. Our military is in charge of pulling us out. They're the ones who plan it out. It's not the president of the United States. What, you know, there's nothing Donald J. Trump or Joseph Biden ever did in their freaking lives that would give them the type of authority to plan out, you know, taking troops out of a goddamn, you know, a Disney park, let alone Afghanistan. So I'm pretty sure that the military would have probably pulled the troops out the same way as under Donald Trump as they did with Biden. So that's a bunch of bullshit. Anybody who has, you know, any ounce of truth in them and reason in them would understand that. You know, the military has a strategy in pulling us out, and Trump's group and all that stuff can say all they want. But here's the point, right? Trump wants to pivot towards Asia, and I like that. I am for that. But the whole, ladies and gentlemen, listen to me here. The whole goddamn reason we're pivoting towards Asia is to make sure that Asia doesn't break out of containment, China breaks out of containment, and take over Eurasia. And guess where Afghanistan is, ladies and gentlemen? It's in fucking Eurasia. So the whole point of saying that we need to stop China and their Belt Road Initiative, so they'll encroach on our markets. All right, so we're pivoting toward Asia, right? We're the island chains. Great, that's cool. But what about the other side? We had China surrounded. We were in Afghanistan. Hello. What about Russia? Let's say the moron crowd out there that thinks Russia and Jesus are two bros, right? Let's say if you're a realist and you know what's going on. What about if we did have a war with Russia? All right, we have NATO troops in Europe, and then we had troops in Iraq, and we had troops in Afghanistan. Guess what? We had Russia surrounded. Let's say if we have a big deal we have to go through with Iran. We have troops in Iraq. We have troops in Afghanistan. We have our Navy is in the South Pacific Ocean. I'm sorry, the Indian Ocean. Guess what? We have them surrounded. Guess what, cheese dicks? We don't anymore. That's what's pissing me off. So people can go online and they can, you know, all this bullshit rhetoric from Breitbart and all these bullshit channels and all the bullshit bots, you know, these bot farms where these people are doing these copy and paste quotes. It's the same ones over and over again. They're not real. They're morons. All right. So, you know, we gave up the center of the chessboard, and I'm still pissed to this day. It still pisses me off. It pisses me off that people out there, that it's not that there's people out there that I can sit there and talk this and tell them, hey, what's going on? Do you want America to win? Yes. Do you want the United States to have an advantage? What if war is unavoidable? Would you want us to have the upper ground? That you know, the commanding heights, the center of the chessboard, all of that. Yes, yes, yes. Then why the hell would you want us to get out of Afghanistan, you stupid son of a bitch? Okay, so let's just skip that for a while. NATO. All right, so if Trump wins and his I hope he's just using rhetoric. I hope, you know, but he already pulled out of Afghanistan. So, you know, you kind of got to go with that. But what about NATO? Now, this last week, NATO got together, and you guys, like, I got some of the best sleep I've been able to get in a long time because of what they said. All right. Basically, they said that they can take on Russia without the United States. That's the NATO countries. Without the United States, they can do this. And it made me, I'm not kidding. It was like I could breathe, you know. So they have two things that are in the way of Trump. One is that NATO will react to Russia's threats without the United States. It's about goddamn time, by the way. When I voted for Trump twice, Trump said specifically, and by the way, Trump's not the one who came up with this. This was Republicans coming up with these arguments way before Trump. He was still doing his TV show. But the reality is that we were always complaining about NATO countries not paying their commitment to NATO or to the alliance, their fair share. So when Trump came along and he said, I'm going to make them do that. Hell yeah, that was awesome. Hey, yeah, kick ass. You guys, remember, I used to do audios on it. Stop taking advantage of us. Whatever suggested once that we should get out of NATO. We built that alliance. That alliance was our idea. It wasn't an internationalist, or it was United States of America. If Russia takes over Ukraine, they're going to use that population and just add that more many people to their army. If Russia takes over Poland, they're going to take over Poland and use that population and just add that many more people to its population, to its army. And on down the road, you know, that's how it works. And then what they want to do is the key to all of this, ladies and gentlemen, the key to all of this is production. They can expand their population like what they had during the USSR. then their production is at a pretty good level. So they have people that can fight wars, and they have production. What defeats the Atlantic and the Pacific Ocean are two big walls that protect us. We can do anything. We are God's chosen people. We have the best land you can have on the planet, and we're protected by two oceans. But there is something that can defeat that. It's called production. And the Russians have been talking about it forever. It's called the world island versus the outer islands. You and I live on the outer island. The world island is Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, or Europe, Asia, and Africa. And if they can get those, control most of it, and outproduce the United States, it will defeat the Atlantic and the Pacific, our barriers. They can do it through production. That's our policy. That's how we look at things. That's what we're doing. And so there's an asshole out there. Doesn't matter if he's about to get shot or he got shot or whatever. There's an asshole out there who wants to stop that, huh? Yeah. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, brilliant. Yeah, you and your God and you're brilliant. Yeah, you're all brilliant. Think about it for about 2 seconds. All right, that's the problem. So this is what's going to happen if Trump wins. And I'm hoping, you guys, this is what I'm hoping. There's a side conversation on Trump saying that he wants to stop the war without giving Russia a victory. All right. But it never came from Trump's lips. It's people are around him saying, well, you know, there's this option, you know, art of the deal. And basically what it is Trump will arm the living shit out of Ukraine and Russia gets to keep what they've taken over. They've already taken. You know, if something like that pops up, great, but Trump's never said anything like that. Those are people saying that that's one of the options that are on the table. They never even said that he said that. So I could live with that. I could live with that. But, but we go by what we can prove in a court of law, right? So we can't use that. God, I hope that's true. I'm not kidding. I hope something like that is on the table and that's true. Because, you know, World War III is not going to be fought over Ukraine. World War III is going to be fought over Poland. And so here's the math, you guys. I'm going to read a couple of some good stuff here. I know a lot of you guys disagree with me on this stuff like that, but I appreciate you listening anyways. And for the people who worship me, I'm just kidding. But it is a fun conversation. It is. This is good stuff to have, because the reason I'm going to give you these dates and how to think is to prepare yourself. That's all I'm doing. I'm not here to try to prove my point is right or anything like that. I want you people to be prepared for what could happen in Iraq as far as investing, so you can adjust. And if Biden wins, what's going to happen? You need to be able to adjust. If Trump wins, what could happen? You need to be able to adjust. That's all this is, okay? So, let me see. That's China. We'll go to Ukraine. All right. So this is a report. I was talking with Bob when I started this audio, and I had to erase a bunch of stuff because I'll read right through it and I will get in trouble. But the stuff that's private for them, but the rest of the stuff is public. All right. So United States plans to stop Russia advance in Ukraine through several key strategies, which is my PowerPoint here. All right. Provide substantial financial aid. The recently approved $61 billion aid package for Ukraine is aimed at preventing Ukraine's defeat and bolstering its defense capabilities. So here, let me get to this part. So let me throw this out there. I'm gonna actually approach this a little bit different for you guys, because you guys would get this stuff. All right. So the significant investment represents less than 4% of the U.S. defense budget, but is seen as crucial for U.S. security interests. Supplying military equipment The aid package is expected to include essential military hardware such as artillery shells, anti-aircraft missiles, tanks, advanced electronic warfare capabilities. This equipment is intended to help Ukraine slow Russia's advance and protect its troops and its civilians. So having said that, you guys, we're not equipping Ukraine to win a war. We're equipping Ukraine to exhaust Russia out. That's what we're doing. We're specifically doing that. All right. Expanding weapons usage. There are calls to change the rules of engagement for U.S. supplied weapons, allowing Ukraine to strike military and military related targets, not just in occupied Ukraine, but also in Russia. Expediting aid delivery, all that stuff. But what sustaining long-term support. The U.S. is developing a strategy for contained support of Ukraine over the next 3 to 5 years, recognizing that long wars require sustained strategic vision. The reason I wanted to read that to you guys specifically, because I just said that without the United States, NATO is prepared to move forward. Okay, so that's Trump gets in. And NATO moves forward without the United States. Now they can't stop the aid that we've already committed to them. That's already written in law. Just like Biden couldn't stop pulling out of Afghanistan if he wanted to, because Trump had it ratified and it was written in law. People don't understand that, we are a nation of laws. All right. All this stuff makes me happy. There's a lot more here, but this is what the experts are saying. If you go completely the other way, let's say Trump gets in and Trump, has the ability to stop support for Ukraine and it has an effect on the battlefield. NATO doesn't step up for whatever reason, internal attacks. They just don't have the wherewithal to do it. Whatever, doesn't matter. Let's say Russia, it takes them a couple years and Russia takes over Ukraine. The war will stop. It'll take, and this is the point that I need you guys to understand, it'll take exactly 4 years from the day that Russia wins that war. It'll take 4 years for them to rebuild their military to go after Poland. So you need to write that down. That's what all the top military advisors from NATO, from the United States, you name it, from England. When Russia wins the war, they'll have to go through a recoup period. It'll take them 4 years, and then they'll be ready to go after Poland, which is exactly what they said they're going to do. So I taught it since 1998. It's Russian policy. I told people, all the way up until they attack Ukraine, Russia's the key to their advancement is attacking Ukraine, taking over Ukraine. They even told everybody. All right. So remember the key issue here, though. This is when after Russia wins, if they win the Ukrainian war, there'll be a 4-year gap. And then they'll go after Poland. What does that mean? That means World War III. That's what that means. Just so you know, you're being warned. You are being warned. If Trump's rhetoric is what he really thinks, and there's no reason for anybody to think otherwise, he pulled us out of Afghanistan. We had the center of the chessboard. We had the commanding heights over everybody. And the son of a bitch pulled us out. I don't give a shit who shot him in the ear. The son of a bitch pulled us out. All right? So, World War III will be fought over Poland. That's what will start, World War III. So that's what's coming down the road, just so you know. Just so you know. I hope I'm wrong. I hope that the policy changes. I hope for the first time Trump is not going to do what he says he's going to do, because I think he's going to win. Guys, all right, this is what sucks, and I'm not kidding, this absolutely sucks. I'm only pissed off and can't stand the idea of him winning just because of that issue. But the issue that's going to start World War III, I think, is a good moral standing. I don't want anybody to go through that. And it's going to happen. And I'm telling you right now, the Russians want it to happen. They want World War III to happen. So you all know they don't. Yes, they do. They said they want it to happen. The people who put these plans together said they want this to happen. Otherwise, this ship's just going to keep on going and going and going. But what they're trying to set up World War III to where they completely win. That's why they don't mind doing it. In their minds, they think they can completely win. They think that the West won't respond correctly. The United States won't respond properly. It'll give them the big win. They're fully expecting World War III. So, you know, just so you guys know, that's the map. The top military thinkers, the top planners, all that stuff say that if Russia wins in Ukraine, there'll be a four-year gap, and then they're going to go after Poland. And then you're going to... So the reason I was throwing up all this information about what the United States can do, it's to push that off, you know, to try to crack the egg as many places as possible so it just stops them for as long as possible. And in the meantime, you have the NATO countries are spooling up its military industry, their production, and try to give them as much time to make as much as possible so Russia doesn't have the advantage if World War III is to start. Do you guys understand? Very simple. That's all this conversation is about. So you have a timeline for yourself on what could happen based on reality, based on facts, based on strategy, what Russia's doing, what NATO's doing, and what the United States wants to do. So if Biden becomes president, and it sucks, you guys seen what's going on, all right? The guy is older than dirt, and I disagree with almost every policy. It's just a piece of shit, all right? I don't like the guy. I didn't like the guy when he was in good health. So, NATO will, or Ukraine will get everything. They'll get everything they asked for. And it'll be pushed off. That war will be pushed off. Now, what I did is I sent Bob a link, and it's going to be below, and it's General Hodges, which is my favorite. And he's talking about how what Russia's capable of doing, their capacity, at what rate they're fighting this war, and how he's saying from today, from us giving Ukraine $61 billion in aid, and we didn't give it all to them at once, you know, it'll be in chunks and pieces, and the type of hardware that we're given, that Russia has a short fuse of about 2 years. So if we keep giving Ukraine aid, Russia, for the most part, you know, they won't be able to sacrifice more than 2 years. That's on the line. That's on the line. So let's switch to Asia. Or I'm sorry, China. I'm gonna do another audio, and I'm gonna filter out some of the names that I'm reading that I can't give you, but there's names that are public that I can give you. I just want to make sure I don't do this incorrectly, and I give you the names that I'm able to give you. But let's do the ones for Taiwan. So what is the predictability of Taiwan? Trump wins or Biden wins? All right, it's going to be exactly the same, because both are anti China attacking Taiwan. So let's just go over some names. Several individuals have mentioned or predicted that China, the attack on China by 2027. So here's a list of the key figures who have discussed this timelines. And the PowerPoint that I have goes through every word, shows all the maps, what they point out, everything that you could possibly find. All right, General Miley. Well, he didn't predict an attack. He stated that China wants the ability to invade and hold Taiwan by 2027. All right. Admiral Phil Davidson, as a former head of the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command, he testified in 2021 that China could try to take Taiwan by force in the next 6 years, which would be by 2027. Joseph Wu, Taiwan foreign minister, expressed concerns about potential conflict with China in 2027. All right. Xi Jinping, while not predicting an attack, U.S. intelligence reports that Xi, who's the head of China, has ordered Chinese military to be prepared for the annexation of Taiwan by 2027. You guys starting to see a pattern here? So it doesn't matter if Trump or Biden wins, you know, that has no one way or the other, this is going to go down. All right. General Mike, and I've chopped this name up. It's Minihan, Minihan. I hope I'm saying that right. Although he didn't specifically mention 27, he predicted a conflict could occur in 2025 to 2027. So you guys got to understand, all right, these names that I put out there, and you have Xi himself. These guys are the best information that you can get on what a military can do to us or attack Taiwan or whatever, you know, the apex, all the agencies combined, and all bottlenecks to these guys. They get the best information there is, and every single one of them is 2027. So you need to adjust. You need to, you know, how will this work? How will this, you know, what do you need to do to prepare your family? And that's all this information is about. Like I said, I'm not trying to make a political statement here. When I talk about Trump, I'm talking about just strategy. From a political point of view, I'm an ultra conservative, you guys. I'm born and bred Lutheran, baptized in a Lutheran church, Protestant conservative my whole life, and I'll never change. All right, so that's, you know, even though you have Bannon and those guys, it's a completely different crowd, but there's a lot in common. So none of this is political. I disagree with, you know, strategy sucks. Strategy is going to get millions of people killed. Mark my words, it's going to happen, because I'm telling you right now, Trump's going to get elected. And, you know, yes, he'll get rid of the immigration problem. Well, that's cool. Great. That's what I want. You know, but World War III, bitches. It's going to happen. So let me switch gears here. I have some more stuff for you guys, I think. Nope, that's pretty much it, you guys. So there's stuff here, but I'm just being, so just do a small review. All right. As of now, we're talking. I don't think there's any, there's still nothing stopping the Iraqis from expanding their markets and adding value to the currency. All right. I do want to add one thing, that the part that I was talking about earlier about someone coming after me. Well, one of the statements I made, and this is 2011, was that Turkey. So Turkey went through a revaluation process. All right. And I can't remember. It's like, it took them like 8 years to go through that process. And at the height of their inflation, they were at 75%, and you know, their inflation was at 75%. 75%. Well, they started doing, they had different policy acts and stuff like that, doing different, put stuff together. And then it came down to where their inflation was 8%. And then they actually redenominated their currency. All right. So, they're, you know, Iraq could go through that. They could, same thing. They could start, the inflation should, could start to go down and then not revalue like they said they're going to do. But the sooner or later, they're going to have to do it. That's the whole purpose of doing it. That's the point. But there's a difference between, so the person who came after me and said, well, you know, that Iraq, or I'm sorry, Turkey actually revalued at 8%. No, dipshit. They went through a redenomination process at the end of that process, but their inflation was 75%. So you're wrong. Nice try, by the way. And that's what they, and that's what these guys were trying to do. They were trying to take pieces that people couldn't fit together. But you guys can go to any AI, Google it or whatever. You'll see the inflation was 75% and more. And then, you know, it took them a few years to get it down. But I think it was 8%. They actually pulled the trigger and redenominated. But the whole point was to get the inflation down to a point so that they could redenominate. So the guy was, you know, I said 75%. He's like, well, no, you're wrong. It's like, no, I'm not wrong. So here's the issue with that. I wanted to point this out because a lot of you even asked me questions about that, and that makes me happy. All right. That was a real market inflation. They couldn't, their market was stagnant. They couldn't boost production. They couldn't boost sales. Iraq doesn't have that problem, ladies and gentlemen. They have energy. Everybody wants their energy. When their currency was at $3 plus, they had less customers than they do today. Think about that. So where's the inflation coming from? The inflation is coming from policy. It's artificial inflation. So that's why we do Policy Watch. One more reminder. We're watching, you know, you don't need to watch their markets. Their markets are fine. Markets are stellar, kick ass. What are they selling? They're selling energy. They're selling a ton of it. They're not selling less. They're not, you know, there's no threat for them to sell less. There's only in the future of them selling more and more and more. But the currency that you and I have does not represent that true market. It's artificial inflation. Turkey did not have artificial inflation. It took them all those years to go from 75% inflation. I think it was actually 79% inflation. But anyways, we'll just use 75. 75% inflation down to 8. And when they did 8, they redenominated. Right? Iraq already redenominated, ladies and gentlemen. That's how you and I ended up with their currency. And they might change the denominations later on down the road. We've talked about that again and again and again. But, you know, it's policy that will change the value of Iraq. You don't need to look for their markets. And the reason I'm answering that in that context, because people keep saying, it's like, what does Iraq have to do market-wise? Like, you know, I'm worried because there's this green, all this new green tech out there, and you won't need Iraq's. You guys, that's not going to stop these oil cut. You know, they just lower the prices of energy, and it beats the, you know, so you have a cost, right, of solar panels and all that stuff. Well, if you lower the cost of using fossil fuels, then nobody can compete against it. They're not going to just, people aren't going to just switch off because it's a some type of moral imperative or anything like that. And they want the best deal that you can get. So the whole Middle East, OPEC, you know, all these oil giants have that card in their deck to play. So if there really is going to be a major push from, you know, the greenies on getting rid of fossil fuels, and, you know, it's like, okay, this is about to take over. You'll see the price of fossil fuels go down. That's how you compete. We haven't seen that, have we? We're not about to see that. We're not about to say that. We're nowhere close to seeing that. So you don't need to worry about that. But Iraq, its inflation is market. It's policy driven. It is not market driven. It is policy driven. All these other countries had to do with their. It was a true market rate. If you look at the end of World War II, you know, because people were pointing out, like, look, after World War II, Germany was in the same situation. No, they weren't. Nobody was trying to cheat back in those days. You know, their inflation was real. We had to build their production back up. So that's what we did. When we rebuilt Germany and we rebuilt Japan, and don't let anybody tell you that we didn't, we did. We baked into those systems the U.S. dollar and our economic system. You know, that's why the dollar is dominant, specifically because of that. So there's a few clowns out there running around saying, no, Germany, we didn't rebuild Germany. Germany built Germany. You're full of shit. We built Germany. We built Japan. So we built most of Europe. We built most of Europe. So it might hurt your feelings. It might hurt your ego, whatever tough shit. But the reality is that, you know, you guys need to look at the policy for Iraq. And then, you know, they if they start peeling back some of the things that keep the value of the dinar down, and a lot of it has to do with its note count. And by the way, we have an audio coming up. I have an audio coming up on specifically talking about the note count again. The M1, the M2, the M3, and how, you know, these I don't even know what to call these people that are against us, like it's a religion or something like that, you know, how they get everything wrong. And so we'll go through, and it's like, what's the proof of where do we find the note count at, if you're going to find it at all? And so we'll go through that. But you guys, thank you for your patience. Thank you for listening to me today. I needed to talk about some of this stuff. You know, just so you know, I'm not against Trump at all. You know, I'll be honest with you. There's nobody who's in a worse position than me, because I would love to vote for him a third time. But I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to vote for anybody who tries to get rid of NATO. It's just, you know, bullshit. You got to be the dumbest person on the planet. It is so disappointing. It sucks. It literally sucks to be me, because it is that disappointing. You know, but people who agree with them, you know what? You're probably going to get your wish, because I'm telling you right now, I don't think anybody can do, you know, after what just happened, and, you know, Lightning Joe Biden, you know, his performance, Twinkle Toes Joe, you know, these guys aren't going to win anything. So I before I go, I got to tell you one more thing though, because I have close contact with Republicans who are in the know. All right. I still do research for a lot of these guys. And one of the, it's so embarrassing, because it's so bad for the Democrats right now that they're coming to Republicans that are arch enemies, not just, you know, it's like, just another guy on the other side of the aisle. We're talking, these guys have been battling out for 20 years. Like, hey, if you were us, and you needed to get rid of Joe Biden, how would you do it from a legal perspective? You know, and we're like, you can't. And you're like, shucks. You know, you're right. We can't figure out a way to do it either. Unless he resigns, there's no way to do it. And here's what's even a worse position for him. That they can't get rid of Joe because the vice president, Kamala, she's polling 100 times worse than Joe. So they can't just get rid of him. They got to get rid of her. How do you get rid of her? They're living a nightmare right now. And it's, I don't know. It's kind of fun to watch, I'll be honest with you. It's disappointing that I won't vote for Trump if he wants to pull us out of NATO. But, you know, watching these guys, you know, they set this up. They put this on themselves. You know, they knew Joe Biden had these problems years ago. And they also knew Kamala wasn't electable. So why did they do that, by the way? Why did they push her to be vice president? Because if anything had happened to Joe, she's far left, and she would cater to the far left, and she was, you know, she didn't need to go through an election. So somehow she got in there. But now that she's got to go through a general election, if Joe Biden does step down, yeah, she's a sure loser. I mean, they simply do not know what to do. So the reports that you're reading on the news, usually it's all bullshit. But the reports that you're reading on the news is that the top Democrats have given up on trying to ask Joe Biden stepping down. Because he ain't going to do it. You got a guy out there that's batshit crazy who doesn't even know who he is, you know, waiting to get a message from God. You know, he says, I'll step down if God tells me to. Well, that doesn't, even if God does tell you to do something when you're batshit crazy, you don't know you're batshit crazy. You know, how do you know that's God's voice? How do you know, you know, so it just, it gets comical from even more comical from that point on. But guys, I could be completely off the wall as far as the election goes. I could be wrong. But I'm telling you right now, the math that these guys I'm with have is Trump is up nationwide 6 points. And that's 2 points above the 4% margin of error. All right, that's massive. That is massive at this point in time. Do you understand what a swing that is? Because you have the independents that were not going to vote for Trump. And I don't know the exact data points. I don't know if, you know, they changed their minds or they're still not going to vote for Trump. But there's Democrats who are like, screw it, I'm not voting. You know what I mean? I don't know how to. You know, they won't give me that information. I don't have that access to that information, but I do know that Trump is up 6 points nationally. Forget about this bullshit that these guys are showing on the news. And you know, there's Biden's not going to, how the hell is Biden going to make that up? Any combination. What if you got rid of Kamala and brought in somebody else? That's not going to help. You know, it's just simply not going to help. So it's Trump's election right now. It's Trump's election. And that's not good for Poland later on down the road time. But anyways, you guys, any questions on this or anything like that, please hit me up at brightlingcurrency@gmail.com. And I'll have some more audios come up for you guys later on down the road.
Hey, Tony, real quick.
Yes, sir.
Don't mean to interrupt.
Yes, sir.
It just came over that Trump selected J.D. Vance as his VP.
Well, that's kind of interesting because I just read an article where it said that Carson was going to be his pick. I guess those guys were wrong, right?
Yeah.
So that's a good pick. That's a good pick. You know, because you had Rubio that was up there, but those two went at it. And in politics, when two guys go at it in the same party, there's always forgiveness. They both sides know. But that's an interesting pick. That's a good pick. So it, you know, it'll probably give them you know, more points above the 6% nationally. But anyways, you know, that's where the nation sits right now, you guys. That's where everything's at. That's where the numbers are at. And we'll have audio coming up here for you guys pretty soon, talking about the M1, the M2, the M3, the Iraq's economic report, and how to cipher that and all that good stuff. And so you guys, thank you so much for your patience. And there's a lot of people out there, and I know I pissed off, told them to screw off with the conspiracy. I know you guys still listen to me, because I even get emails from them saying, but I appreciate you toning down the emails that you guys were sending me. That was the big issue. The threats. Just cussing me out because I didn't believe in what they believed in. You know, that doesn't fly. So that's why I got in. By the way, I don't regret doing it. You know, it did. It toned things down. And that's all it was about. All right. So just contemplate what I said today. Prepare yourself mentally if Russia wins in Ukraine. What does that mean? What's the next steps? 4 years, and then they're going to go after Poland. You will see World War III. What did I say about Taiwan? 2027. Everybody and their dog is saying 2027. It's not even cool to be, you know, to know that because everybody's using that number. But so 2027. That will kick off. All right. So you guys, any questions? Please hit me up. As far as the moral issue goes with Hamas being in Iraq and, you know, should you stay? That's on you. I'll wait to see what happens and all that stuff. But if Hamas gets into Iraq is in trouble, not just its oil is in trouble. All right. Yeah, look at Iran. Iran has all kinds of oil. You know what I mean? And they're in trouble because of the ship they're pulling all the time. Well, Iraq could be in that exact same spot. It's not about just having oil. It's having access to your customers. And Hamas being in Iraq is a game changer. That's a game changer. That's going to shift the markets. So all we can do is hope and pray and watch. But Bob, yeah, you have anything you need to add or anything you want to ask? Anything you know that I forgot?
No, I think you pretty much got it this time, bro. I know we're going to talk more about the M1s all through this next presentation. But for now, I think what most people were interested in because of this last weekend was the events of somebody trying to shoot Trump. But yeah, I think you covered it all. That's good enough for now.
Well, let me say this. So you guys, you know, I'm sure you guys understand it's going to get interesting this election. All right. And if I can ask you for anything, beg you, don't get involved with anything. Vote your conscience, right? Don't get involved with any fights. Don't go out and shoot somebody. You know, especially this crowd, because you guys are believers, right? We are not of this world. Our God is not of this world. And I'm not going to partake of any of that type of evil. Absolutely refuse to do it. 1,000 years from now, the Republican Party, the Democrat Party, all this bullshit won't even be here. And what will all the action, all the hate, all the emotion, it'll be for nothing. You'll just be embarrassed. Just get the popcorn out and watch. Because it will be interesting, but do not partake in evil. Don't get wrapped up into it. Anyways, thank you, everybody. God bless.